Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Welcome to February in 2017 in Iowa. I hope everybody's had a chance to enjoy this beautiful weather. I've seen a lot of concerned posts on Facebook about global warming and how they're too scared to enjoy the weather and all this stuff. And I'm like, we're not even setting a record high yet, but I'll take it. I'll take it and I'll enjoy it and thank the Lord for it.
What was it, 1928?
Yeah. I have a 19-year-old that knows everything because he's in college and knows more than his mother, so I don't go there. It's just a fact, he tells me.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, well, I happen to know truth, so we'll just stop right there.
How do you think global warming?
I'm not going to go there. That's not what I wanted to talk about this morning. But praise the Lord. I wanted to talk about the truth that sets you free. That is something I would much rather talk about this morning. And the scripture from the devotional says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." And I think one of the most interesting things in this section that he talks about, he said, "Listen closely to the words our Lord Jesus proclaimed in today's scriptures. Notice how the Spirit of the Lord and his anointing are upon those who preach the true gospel. And look at the results of the true gospel. The curse of poverty is destroyed, broken hearts are mended, prisoners and the oppressed are set free, and the sightless receive sight. Through the preachings of God's amazing grace, people are set free to live a victorious and a glorious life. Not a life entangled with sin, doubt, apprehension, and defeat." Here is a foundational scripture that he wants to go deeper inside of our hearts. "For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." The law that was given through Moses refers to the Sinaitic covenant named after Mount Sinai, where the Ten Commandments were given. So whenever we hear the word "the law," think of the Ten Commandments. The Sinaitic covenant was a covenant that was made between God and Israel, not between God and the church. Our covenant is the new covenant of grace, which began at the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice also that the Ten Commandments were given by a servant, by Moses, but that grace and truth came through God's own Son, through Jesus Christ. Now don't let anyone tell you that the truth here is the Ten Commandments. The verse is clearly contrasting the Mosaic law on one side with grace and truth on the other side. Truth is on the side of grace, not the Ten Commandments. In the original text, the word for grace and truth are followed by a singular verb for came, which means that grace and truth are regarded as one item. Grace is the truth, and the truth that sets people free is grace. So you cannot separate grace and truth. They are a composite whole. Let me say it again. Grace is the truth, and truth is grace.
Yes.
Why is knowing this so important? Because grace, not the law, is the truth that sets you free and transforms you.
Yes.
And then that's how we can understand that when Jesus talked to the woman who was caught in the act of adultery, she said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Now go and sin no more." That was grace and truth as a composite whole in action. Grace does not condemn the sinner, but it also does not condone sin. Grace pardons the undeserving sinner, and the result of grace is the power to go and sin no more.
Yes.
Isn't that beautiful?
Yes.
That's who our Lord Jesus Christ is.
Yes.
He loves the sinner and releases him or her with the power and the strength to go and sin no more. A person whose heart is full of the love of Jesus doesn't need to find love in an adulterous relationship. All of your need for security, affirmation, and love is fully met in the person of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You don't have to settle for a life trapped in sin when you know that Jesus has such a beautiful and glorious future for you.
Yes.
And I wanted to also read something that struck my heart as I was going through. I love this book, but it says, take time to listen.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been asking the Lord a lot lately. I just keep feeling like I ask amiss. And I think what he's telling me is stop asking and listen. So I'm going to share my conversation with the Lord a little bit this morning. And the scripture in this section is Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 2, which is what I believe he wants all of us to listen to this morning, is the blessings he's pouring out on us. But this is a snippet from Deuteronomy chapter 28. And all these things shall come upon you and overtake you if you heed the voice of the Lord your God. Let's see. I want to start here. If you are anxious about the needs and demands of tomorrow, keep hearing how God is for you and not against you. Hear how he has freely given you all things through Christ, so that all you need to do is to freely receive all of his blessings, including the favor, wisdom, healing, and supply you need for whatever challenge you may be facing. Hear the Son remind you of your loving Heavenly Father, who knows your every need and promises he will take care of you and you, if as you cast your cares on him and simply seek his and simply seek first his gift of righteousness. My dear friend, if you listen and become established in his grace toward you, every worry and every anxiety will evaporate like the mist as the morning sun comes up, and you will see his fresh supply of favor for every new need. If you've ever experienced the sting of betrayal, if you've been hurt by the words of people close to you, or if you're just feeling pain, plain discouraged, hear the Lord's words of affirmation. Hear him say to you, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Let these words restore your heart, bring stability to your emotions, and give you the faith to boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? My friend, to really grow in grace and see its fruit manifest in our lives, we need to keep hearing the Son and his words of grace. Because it is so easy to slide back into beginning law or demand consciousness, as opposed to being grace or supply conscious. Hear him today. Hear his words of grace. And the scripture tells us faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of the Lord. And so I think what he's saying, instead of coming and asking, seek what we want him to say to us. When we're fearing or when we're doubting, listen to him. Take up the word and listen to what he tells us for what our need is. And then listen to him. And I know that I talk out loud to myself all the time because I want to hear, right? I speak things out loud because I want to hear for my own hearing. Because just because I'm reading it in my mind. But my ears need to hear it. So I read things out loud all the time. I drive my coworkers crazy because I read things out loud all the time because I'm an audible learner. Yes. I sink things in through my ears. And so I talk out loud. I add numbers out loud. It drives my coworkers crazy. I usually have to just like, okay, I'll stop. But I think this morning, I'm going to read from Deuteronomy chapter 28 because I think the Lord wants us to listen to him this morning. Because our own voices tend to condemn us. Our own voices and our own minds tend to tell us things that are not true. They tend to agree sometimes with the enemy, more so at least in certain situations that are challenging, right? Our own inner talk wants to tell us untruths. And so that's where we need to stop that inner talk and replace it with what the Lord says. And so this morning, I'm going to tell you the blessings of obedience. And I want you to know that we don't need to be obedient because Jesus Christ has already fulfilled the law.
Yes.
He has been obedient unto death. He has been obedient unto resurrection. He has been obedient unto the destruction of death, hell, and the grave. There is nothing for us to obey. It is for us to simply believe and receive.
Yes.
And so the blessings of obedience that were promised to Israel are now a covenant of blessings for us that we cannot undo, that we cannot break, we cannot unearn, because Jesus Christ has just let it flow from him. If you will listen diligently to the voice of the Lord, your God, being watchful to do all his commandments, which I command you this day, what he tell us? He has two commandments. Love the Lord with all your heart and love thy neighbor as yourself. That's all we have. If we love, these are the blessings that flow. The Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth. And all of these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you if you will heed the voice of your Lord, of the Lord God. Blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the field. Blessed shall the fruit of your body, and the fruit of your ground, and the fruit of your beasts, the increase of your cattle, and the young of your flock. Blessed shall be your basket and your kneading through. Blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out. The Lord shall cause your enemies to rise up against you, to be defeated before your face. They shall come out against you one way and flee before you seven ways. The Lord shall command the blessings upon you in your storehouse and all that you undertake. And he will bless you in the land which the Lord your God gives you. The Lord will establish you as a people holy to himself, as he has sworn to you, if you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways. And all the people of the earth shall see that you are called by his name and in the presence of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of you. And the Lord shall make you have a surplus of prosperity through the fruit of your body, of your livestock, and of your ground in the land which the Lord sware to your fathers to give you. The Lord shall open to you his good treasury, the heavens, to give the rain of your land in its season, and to bless all the work of your hands. And you shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. And the Lord shall make you the head and not the tail. And you shall be above only, and you shall not be beneath. If you heed the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you this day, and are watchful to do them, and you shall not turn aside from any of the words which I command you this day, to the right hand or to the left, to go after other gods to serve them. Now I can tell you that in chapter 28, the curses of the disobedient are much longer than the blessings of the obedient. But we don't have to worry about that. We don't have to worry about any of that. We simply just receive. We are the head, not the tail. We are the lender, not the borrower. Those are the prayers that I remind myself all the time. Everything I touch my hand to prospers. Everywhere I go, light is. We are the salt and the light. And when the enemy comes to whisper, when our own minds, when our own self-talk condemns us, remember who you are. You are an heir, a joint heir with Jesus Christ. You are a king and a priest, sealed by the Holy Spirit of the one true God who came and gave his life for us, resurrected and sealed. We are sealed, branded by the Holy Spirit, set apart. And it's so hard sometimes to live in this world and not be of it. Because it's so easy to just start to look like what we're around. But we are a peculiar people. And that's what this world needs, is somebody who's willing to be peculiar for the Lord. Who's willing to lift the name of Jesus Christ and give them hope and a future. Because there is nothing but death and destruction that we see. Division and strife, anger and frustration. There is more division and naysaying going on. I don't even watch the news anymore. I can't take it. I just say, Lord, you know. And as the darkness comes or goes or whatever, we are light. We don't have to worry about any of that, because wherever we go, is holy land.
Yes.
And so I just encourage everyone today that when you want to worry, when you want to doubt, when the circumstances happen in this life, but that circumstance is not the truth.
That's exactly right.
The truth is who Jesus is and who he has made us to be. And that's what we need to remind each other. And that's why it's so important for us to gather together, to remind each other, to lift each other up. Because when we're off by ourselves and all we hear is our self-talk or the enemy whisper, we need to be reminded that you are special. You are holy and righteous right now, exactly as you are.
Yes.
Because Jesus Christ has made you so.
Yes.
And you deserve every blessing in Jesus' name.
Praise God.
In Jesus' name.
Approach it from that point of view, because we're no longer trying to finish the race.
share this morning? Testimonies, prayer requests? Yeah, Nathan.
I've talked to Tim Patton a couple of times this week and again this morning, but we need to pray for his entire family. You know, his previous wife was released from the hospital. She's doing much better, but her boyfriend passed away Wednesday. I think it was Wednesday the 15th. So that obviously is, you know, really an emotional blow for her and the entire family dealing with all of this right now. So his sons and all of that. So we need to pray for that, their entire family. And also, when he texted me this morning, Leah has had a bit of an issue with her diabetes this morning, and she's really feeling bad, not feeling well at all. So I told him that we would certainly pray for her.
Yeah.
Amen. Believe God.
Amen.
For her total deliverance.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Cindy should be on her way here shortly.
Yay.
Yay.
Praise the Lord. Let's stand and go to the Lord this morning. Invite him in and lift up our knees before him this morning. Heavenly Father, we just come before you this day. We thank you. We thank you, Lord, that it is finished. Lord, that there is no race to be won, Lord, just a victory lap to be run. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that the blessings of obedience, your obedience, are ours through your sacrifice, Lord Jesus. And right now, Lord, there are members of this body that have needs, Lord, that we lift up before you. We come together in one mind and one accord. That you touch Tim's ex-wife's family, Lord, as they mourn the loss of her boyfriend, Lord. That you be comfort and strength in a time of mourning. We ask you to touch Leah this morning, Lord. That diabetes, Lord, is eradicated from her body, Lord. That you bring the wisdom and the healing, Lord. This morning we pray for Carol, Lord. Let her know that she is missed, Lord. And that you touch her body, Lord. And that whatever ailment or disease comes upon her is nourished in your name by your blood, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that Cindy will join us this morning in victory over COPD and over that other disease, Lord. Thank you for her healing, Lord. Lord, and every person here today, Lord, whatever their need may be, Lord, that you come this morning, Lord, that you come and have your way in this service this morning, that you are most welcome here. Come and have your way. Holy Spirit, come. Give us ears to hear and eyes to see, Lord. Things are not as they appear, Lord, and give us wisdom, Lord, and revelation, Lord. Let us be hearers of the word and doers of the word, Lord. That you light the way before us, Lord, that your word is a lamp unto our feet, Lord, that you light the way before us, Lord, that we simply walk in it, walk that victory lap that you have already won for us. We lift you up this morning, Jesus, name above every name. We lift the cross high this morning, and I thank you, Lord, that you endured the cross, and I thank you, Lord, even more that you rose again after the cross. That you slay death, hell, and the grave, and destruction, Lord. I thank you that by your stripes we are healed of every disease, every infirmity, everything that would come against your body, Lord. And I thank you. I thank you for your Holy Spirit that lives inside us, Lord. That never leaves us, that never forsakes us, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that you have chosen us to be your children, heirs and joint heirs, to join the family, the kingdom of God, to know you and to be like you, Lord. Continue your work in each of us, Lord. Continue to renew our minds through the hearing of your word. Jesus, let your word come alive in our hearts, and as it comes in our ears, bring life into our lives. That the fruit of your grace and your love would be manifest. We thank you that the gospel of grace is simple. It's so simple and so powerful. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Have your way this morning, Lord Jesus. In your name, Jesus. And again, just want to remind everybody that this service this morning is the result of all of us. Everybody has different gifts. Everybody has different abilities. So if you have a word of knowledge, a word of wisdom, tongues or interpretations, if you feel the need to pray for somebody, to bless somebody, please, you are free to do so throughout the service this morning. All right, let's speak the word together.
Will you not remind us again that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer. These signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function, and I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Ron and John, you two want to, take the offering this morning, please? You got to help her there, Grandpa. She can come help you. Ron, you want to ask the blessing this morning, please?
Father, I just thank you. You give us all things to sustain the life and the body.
Yes.
Thank you for your Lord Jesus Christ who made everything possible. Thank you for the opportunity to give into your kingdom. I pray over this offering that you will bless it. Bring the kingdom of God here on earth. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. 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 As Suzanne was bringing forth word. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening. On the back side of one of my sheets, the resounding hymn from the past came forth, and I just want to repeat the words I know I've heard of music before. You get the podium right now.
Thank you.
The last of the first verse is,
"Awake my soul and sing of Him who died for thee, and hail Him as thy precious King throughout eternity."
We're in that eternity right now. We're in that eternity right now, church. And as we're waiting for our miracles to come in our midst, which I know are on our way, I know there's healing that needs to be released in this room right now. There's some that are in pain right now. There's some that have been fighting financial and emotional things. This is a place of healing. And one thing I've learned in the last several months, for sure, is that in all things praise Him. All things praise Him. All things praise Him.
Cause every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus.
this last week, I was right after Sunday school. In fact, going to Sunday school, when the new youth group was forming last Sunday, and they were talking about putting decor down there, just putting their identity out. The thing was brought up, I believe it was Nicole brought up, it was about stars, making stars. Well, this dog talks about this,
yes.
His creation. He created the stars.
Yes.
He knows each one by name. He knows, you know, we're up here coming up with kind of a crazy line of names for all these stars and putting mathematical equations on this star. He knows them all by name, just like he knows us by name. So, yeah, this confirms things, Nicole. Okay? You're speaking it out. And Kennedy was questioning things and stuff. And it's great, because I'm glad you questioned. You need to question these things, okay? And I thank you for your hearts in this matter. But this song talks about these things. I just want to love on the Lord and just thank you for his creation.
Yes.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Even for the faith to believe, it comes from you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your reality. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace and your faithfulness to us, Lord. You are a great and a mighty God. There's none like you, Lord. You alone are God. And we give you all praise, glory, and thanks. For in you, all the fullness of God dwells. Everybody said, in Jesus' name. Amen. Give him a hand this morning. Praise God. Praise God. God bless you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening and sharing the words with us. Thank you, Mike and the worship team. Thank all of you for praying and believing God for the supernatural. Praise the Lord. To intervene in the lives of those that we have prayed for. Amen. For God to show up mightily. Amen. Not that he's far from any one of us, praise the Lord, but praise God. Thank the Lord. The Sunday school kids can be dismissed to go downstairs. Thank you all for being here this morning. It's a beautiful day, and I know a lot of people, I know some of them are out of town, some sick, and others enjoying the weather somewhere else, praise the Lord, but it's all good, amen, praise the Lord. You know, the scripture says, I think Paul said, to rejoice always. He said, and again I say, rejoice. He's not talking about happiness. Because happiness depends on what happens, you know. I mean, it's all based on what's going on around us. So happiness comes and goes with all the stuff. But joy is the reality of God in us that never changes.
Amen.
So we can rejoice always, even when we're unhappy.
Amen.
We can be joyful because that doesn't change. That reality is what makes the difference about everything else. If we don't have it on the inside, what's happening on the outside will overcome us and destroy us. But if you have a knowledge and awareness of God on the inside,
yes,
then whatever happens on the outside is irrelevant. It's just stuff. It's just temporary. Because he is eternal. Praise the Lord. Amen. So I want to go to the Word of God this morning. Thank you again for being here. And let's begin with Luke chapter 4. And we'll read verses 18 through 21. Hallelujah, Jesus. I mentioned Wednesday night. I know some of you may have wondered if I had a date for Valentine's Day. I don't know who that would have been, but somebody might have. And yes, February 14th is the Lord's date for Valentine's Day. I know, but we're just trying to bring things down a little bit. Praise the Lord. Eric, you're probably wondering about my hair. Because, well, I'm just not picking on you. I'm just saying you're the only one that shouldn't have a worry about it, you know. But I only moisturize my hair on one condition. You don't believe me when I say this is my backup plan. In case, praise the Lord. It's all good in Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Some may think that, you know, that offends the Lord. Well, I don't know how it could because he's right here. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
What do you think, Sheila?
Amen.
No, that's good. It's not good.
No, no, no.
Yeah, that's good. That's right. Thanks. Praise the Lord. Okay, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach. This goes to what Suzanne was saying at the very beginning. So this is Jesus speaking, and he's talking about self-revelation, that he has an understanding of who he is and what his purpose is, and that purpose is to reveal God, right? So he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, and sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. How many of you know that we're in that year? Praise the Lord. We are accepted in the beloved. Praise God. All right, Ephesians chapter 1, and I'd like to read verses 3 through 12, Roberto. Ephesians 1, verses 3 through 12. What about a beautiful week, amen? I mean, this has been fantastic. Praise the Lord. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ. Praise the Lord. So if the gospel is not setting us free to live unique lives spiritually, adventurous lives, in living with God every day, then we haven't fully entered into the gospel, into the good news that Jesus brought. If your life is less than that adventure, less than that spiritual adventure in Christ, then you haven't really embraced or understood the depth of what this good news is all about. I'm not saying you're not saved. I'm just saying to be saved is one thing. That you escape hell. We talked about this last week. That's not what the gospel is really all about. That's a benefit.
Right.
But it's not the focus.
Right.
The focus is that God would be revealed here on earth. If that were not the case, then we would have all just gone to be with the Lord as soon as we got saved.
Yes.
We are heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ, and we continue on in the life that Jesus lived. That's why we are the body of Christ, to continue to do what Jesus did. Now, the church or religious has kind of given us the sense that that means that we're supposed to be perfect in all of our ways and everything that we do. Obviously, we want to be good people, but that's not the point. The point is, Jesus' purpose here was not to be a really good person. The purpose of Jesus was to be God in the flesh,
yes,
to reveal or image God,
yes,
to this world.
Yes.
Amen. And without that, then everything else is religion.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 and 18. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 and 18.
Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. All things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Let's just read it again. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away.
Yeah.
We're something different.
Right.
We're not just better humans. We're not just fixed up human beings now. We're something altogether different. We're a whole new creation. Amen? A different creature. Old things, that stuff is all passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. He's put us back with him, amen? And has given to us the ministry of reconciliation, or the ability then to do that for others. Praise the Lord. So think about it. If this is true, then our life is less about trying to press into a God who is outside of us, and all about going deeper into the reality of the perfect union that we already have with God.
Yes. Yes.
So it troubles me sometimes, and I get it. I mean, I understand, because I come from a Pentecostal holiness background. I've been there and done that. But I'm just saying, when we're always talking about trying to get into God or press into God or get more of God, we're missing the reality here.
Right.
It's like Joyce Meyer said, I heard one time years ago, she said, you know, it's like trying to get into a room you're already in the middle of.
Right.
So we say things, and I know we say it's just kind of Christianese stuff. It's just the way we talk. But it undermines really what we're trying to do. If we don't really understand it, we say stuff. Words really have meaning. You know, they do have a purpose. And when we say stuff without realizing what we're saying, we undermine really our own well-being.
Sure.
So we're pressing into God. What are we talking about?
Yeah.
We're pressing into God.
Yes.
Wake up. You are in God.
Amen.
You can't get any more. You can't get any more, God. You just need to get woke up to the fact that you and God are one. That's what the good news of the gospel.
Amen.
That's what it's all about. Amen. In Him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So if we're in Him, we got it all. We are one with God. We've been reconciled to God. God and I are one.
Yes. Yes.
Jesus was the firstborn.
Yes.
Right? What does that mean? He means He was the first human being to be filled with God.
Mm-hmm.
And we are His brethren,
yes.
Offspring of God.
Yes.
I'm not going to get into the biology of it because I don't understand it any more than anybody else does. All I know is that He was born from above, and not by the sperm of a man,
right. But
by the breath of God that created in the womb of a human being this child,
mm-hmm.
that becomes a man filled with God. When we get born again, that's why He says you have to be born again.
Right.
You can't do this in the natural. You have to have the breath of God breathed into you. That's the Holy Spirit coming into us, the life of God.
Yes.
That's what happened when you got saved.
Amen.
You didn't get fixed up.
No.
You got new life. You got God life.
Yes. Yes.
And that's what we have to continuously remind ourselves of. If we really get this, what Paul said about rejoice always, and again I say rejoice, won't be a problem.
Right.
Happiness will come and go. Yeah, there'll be stuff that makes you unhappy because we live in this world. But it can't take your joy. It can't steal your joy. It's something that is constant. It's God in you.
Amen.
The hope of glory.
Yeah.
Praise God. Amen. So it's this ongoing deepening of our awareness and enjoyment of perfect union with God that we already have.
Amen.
In Christ.
Amen.
Look at Romans chapter 11, verses, Romans 11, 36, and then 12, 1 and 2. They're concurrent. I mean, they flow together there. Okay, Romans 11, 36, and then 12, 1 and 2. For of Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be glory forever. Amen. Now, remember, we've talked about this a lot of times. The Bible, when it was written, I mean, it by definition, it is continuous writing.
Mm-hmm.
There's no chapters, verses, paragraphs, punctuation in the original. It's just a continuous flow of God's mind through humans, and they're writing it down. Later on, punctuation, all this stuff came just to help it make it easier for us to read, but it actually sometimes messes things up. So for of Him, through Him, and to Him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen. I beseech you, therefore.
Right.
Why? Because of what I just said. Because of Him, and through Him, and to Him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen. Now this brings context to this idea, amen, of making ourselves a living sacrifice, whereas religion has told us, and it still goes on in some countries to extremes where they beat themselves and they crucify themselves and do all kinds of crazy stuff. But we, you know, we were taught that we need to, you know, beat this thing down, you know, do something to this flesh to keep it from getting out of control. But that's not what this is really about. Of Him, through Him, and to Him are all things, to whom be glory forever. I beseech you, therefore, because of that, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. In other words, you give yourself to God.
Yes.
So that God can live in your body, so that God can live through this flesh.
Yes.
That's what He's talking about. Amen? Present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Just let God live through you. Let God live in you.
Yes.
Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. We know what that is, that God would dwell in us and through us.
Yes. Yes.
All right. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I'm crucified with Christ. This is what we just read. Mm-hmm. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Mm-hmm. All Paul is doing is saying the same thing that he just had said in Romans. Present yourself a sacrifice. You've been crucified with Christ.
Yeah.
It's not you that lives anymore, but it's now God that lives through you. This is not living. Living is on the inside, because when that heart stops pumping, right, this thing just folds up like a cheap suitcase. Because it's only surviving because of what's going on inside.
Exactly.
Amen? So it's like getting a suntan. There's work that you do, but it's just to position yourself so that Christ can do what he does naturally. Transform us into his image, his likeness in himself. Mm-hmm. You don't work to get a suntan. You just get yourself in a position where the sun can tan you. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. I know it's February, but come on. It's really been nice out. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about a position, not a work.
Right.
All right, Romans chapter 8, verse 29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. So, sit down and enjoy what God has done. And don't set out to try and get it for yourself.
Right.
Just relax. Mm-hmm. It's finished. Ephesians 1 and 3. See, God has chosen you. And he's prophesied, or he's declared, that you will be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as God's concerned, you are.
Yes.
Because he is dwelling in you. You and he are one. He's not off out there somewhere that we got to call him down. In fact, I'd even say this. I mean, a lot of what we call prayer, it's monologue. Real prayer is communing with God all the time. That's why he says, pray without ceasing. Well, how in the world do you do that? You got to get in this position. You got to say all the right stuff. You got to, you know, do everything. And prayer is just conversation with God. You can have that in your head. You can have it ongoing. You and he are one.
Yes.
How many of you talk to yourself? Well, I'm feeling it right now. So it's going to be therapy. People are going to make all kinds of money off of us, praise the Lord. But we do, whether we talk out loud to ourselves or not, we've got thoughts rolling around in our head all the time that we're trying to rationalize and compartmentalize and make sense out of. And that's all that we're doing with God. We can do the same thing with God all the time. If you want to talk out loud, that's cool, but you don't have to. So a lot of time, and I'm not saying we shouldn't have, you know, organized prayer. I'm just saying that we don't have to do that to have communion with God.
Amen.
He already knows what you have need of.
Right?
Right? I mean, he already knows what you need. What he really wants is your attention.
Yes. Yes.
Praise God. So blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. All right? Ephesians 2 and 6. Blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Whatever is his is ours. whatever he has accomplished is already accomplished for us and in us. When Tammy was talking about the victory lap, that's the reality. He has given us the victory. We enforce it by declaring that reality. We're not begging God to heal us.
No.
God already healed us in Christ.
Yes.
And if we're aware of that oneness that we have with Christ, we just speak our healing. We just walk out our healing.
Yes.
That doesn't mean you don't have stuff going on in the physical. It means that you don't allow that to distract you from the reality.
Exactly.
You don't let a fact deny the truth. Praise God. Wherever he is, so are we.
Mm-hmm.
Right this second.
Yes.
Not when you get all prayed up. Not next week when you get over the argument you had with your spouse. Or not after you get past the whatever it is that is troubling you. Right this instant. Wherever he is, you are. You can't be in different places if he and you are one. Look, it'll make you think altogether different about yourself. We worry, you know, psychiatrists, and they're making millions off of self-esteem issues. This will cure all your self-esteem problems right now. God has chosen you and dwells in you and will never leave you. Think, this is not just religious rhetoric. This is the truth. This is the reality of what God has done. This is the good news. God and you are one. And he likes it. He's happy about it. He wanted it.
Amen.
We've got to accept our own acceptance.
Yeah.
Now, our youngest daughter, Allison, is pregnant. Some of you have heard that, you know, the testimony Sally was talking about. Her oldest child, Isabel, Izzy, just turned 6. And her mom saw her praying one day and asked her, said, Izzy, what are you praying about? What are you doing? She said, I'm praying. She said, about what? And she said, for a baby sister. She's got 2 little brothers. She's had enough brothers. She wants a sister. So she's praying for a sister. And she didn't know, and Allison didn't know at the time. Allison was already pregnant, but she didn't know it. And Izzy certainly didn't know it. And she went over and put her hand on her mom as she was walking by, put her hand on her belly, and she said, my sister's in there. There's a baby in there. Well, subsequently, Allison found out she was pregnant, but she didn't want to tell the kids because she, you know, it's like a vacation drive, right? When are we going to get there? Are we there yet, you know? Is today the day the baby comes and all that stuff? So she was holding off. Well, then she had a blood clot and had some doctor issues that had to be taken care of. So she was going back to the OBGYN to have an ultrasound. So she took Izzy with her and her Ryan, her husband, took Izzy because they wanted her to be the first one to know because she was so excited and because she'd been praying about it. So they went, they did the ultrasound, and Izzy got to see the little baby, and it's moving and doing what babies do inside the mother's womb, right? And Izzy just freaking out. She said, I prayed for this. I prayed for this. You know, she's just going crazy at the doctor's office. And so they give her a picture of the ultrasound. They got a little folder, and it's talk about my new brother or sister or my new baby or whatever. So they come back by our house on the way home. And of course, Izzy was showing it to everybody and just all excited about this baby. So Colt, the youngest, he says, and what's the baby doing? In fact, he reached in. Her mom was wearing a hooded sweatshirt with a thing, you know, like where you put your hands, and he's reaching in there trying to find the baby. Obviously, he's 3. He hasn't figured this out yet. So she said, no, he's not there. He's in my tummy, you know. But here's the point. What is that baby? I mean, I looked at the ultrasound, and of course, we've all seen these, especially if you have kids or grandkids, or maybe when you were having kids, they were doing this, but what's the baby doing to grow? To mature? Nothing.
Exactly.
It's not doing anything. It's simply abiding in its mother. the one that it's united to, the one that supplies all of its needs.
Yes.
Amen. She receives everything that it needs for life.
Yes.
From the mother without doing anything.
Exactly.
You mothers understand this, you guys. You ought to be able to figure it out, praise the Lord. But here's the reality. Our spiritual lives are to be lived the same way our natural lives begin.
Yes.
That's what Paul is saying in a way in Galatians 3, where he says, having begun in the Spirit, having begun totally dependent on God, why are you now think you're going to take over this?
Right? Yes.
Right? You need to stay in that position where you are just abiding in Him, and He supplies all your needs according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. He'll take care of your maturity. He'll take care of your growth if you stay focused on Him. If you just rest in Him.
Yes.
Keep Him the focus. It's not something we do. It's an internal posture.
Yes.
It's recognizing, this is all I got to do.
Exactly.
Trust Him. He will lead you and guide you.
Yes.
Colossians 1, verse 17. He is before all things, and by Him all things consist. Now, verse 27. He's before all things, by Him all things consist. To whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So we can't get the presence of God because we're already totally in the presence of God. What's missing is awareness.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I heard somebody say, you ever been in a worship service that was boring? I'm not asking you to raise your hands. I'm just rhetorical. I'm just saying, no, it's impossible. Because that wasn't worship.
Right.
It was something else. I don't know what else it was, but it wasn't worship. Because worship can't be boring. It's celebrating the awareness of God's presence.
Yes.
We can do that all the time, but we specifically do it in church services. And you can have worship services in your own home, obviously. We do that. But I'm just saying, there's no such thing as a boring worship service.
That's the truth.
It's just not a worship service if it's boring. And our lives, a lot of times, are boring as Christians. But that's an oxymoron.
Right.
You can't be a Christian and be bored. Not if you understand.
Exactly.
I mean, just what we're talking about here, how can you be bored if you know that God is with you all the time, always trying to reveal Himself, always trying to make Himself aware of you, to you, and always trying to lead you and guide you into this adventure, amen, that He calls life, this life.
Yes.
But it's eternal life because we already have God in us.
Amen.
So if you're bored, wake up.
Yes.
Get aware. Praise the Lord. So we can't get the presence of God because we're already totally in the presence of God. What's missing is awareness. God is maintaining us in existence with every breath that we take.
Yes, He is.
Every time we take a breath, God is choosing us. Now. 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 Now, just like we're in the mother's womb, he gives life. And every time we take a breath, it's God acknowledging us again and again and again and again.
Uh-huh.
Every time you take a breath in this life, it's God saying, I love you. I'm with you. I'm for you. I'm sustaining you. I'm keeping you. You are important to me. I love you.
Yes. Amen.
Romans chapter 6. Verses 4 through 11. He's maintaining our existence.
Amen.
to whom God would make known. Oh, sorry. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we've been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Yes.
That's not complicated.
No.
Is it?
No.
But it changes everything.
Yes, it does.
Because it takes religion completely out of the picture and makes this just about you and God. Human logic is not the ground where faith is cultivated. Real faith is cultivated when we are confronted with the illogical love that God has for us.
Amen.
Got it? I mean, do you understand what I'm saying? If you know how much God loves you, his commitment to you, faith can soar.
Yes.
Why? He's not going to let you down. He's not going to fail you. It's only when we make it about us that faith has problems. Because we know we are constantly wavering in our humanity, in our flesh. But he is consistent. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he's in you and for you all the time.
Yes.
This may sound silly and trite, but I'm telling you, this is so important, and we've missed it for years. Or at least I have. Maybe y'all got this and I'm just coming in, you know, on the turnip truck. But I'm saying this isn't something I've really understood or really lived in until the last year or two.
Right. Yes.
I'm not saying I wasn't saved. I'm just saying
right.
I was saved, but I was still miserable half the time. Because it was more about me than it was about what he had already done, what he's already accomplished. And that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What's fascinating is to realize that we are completely surrounded by and consumed by the full presence of God.
Yes.
Every hour,
yes.
Every second of every day.
Amen. Amen.
Never a time that we aren't totally one. Impossible to separate. John 14, 20. If you can embrace this, I'm telling you, life gets better.
Oh, yes.
The things that trouble us pale in comparison to this reality. That's why you can have joy unspeakable and full of glory. That's why you can rejoice. And again, I say rejoice in all things. At that day, you shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. So the real difference in Christianity isn't between conservatives and liberals. It's not between charismatics and evangelicals. But it's between the awake and the asleep. Praise the Lord. Either we're awake to the presence of God or we're asleep.
Yes.
Awake to righteousness,
yes,
and sin not.
Yes.
Awake to your position in Christ.
Amen.
And don't worry about the rest of it.
Yes.
Back to Luke chapter 4, verses 18 through 21. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister and sat down, and the eyes of all of them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And I'm sure they were thinking, is he nuts? Because later they want to throw him off a cliff.
Sure.
Why? Because he was telling them what I'm telling you.
Yes.
He was one with God.
Yes.
He was a son of God.
Yes.
But they wanted their religion, and they said, he's a blasphemer. And all he was doing was trying to show them what God was trying to tell them and had been trying to tell them for thousands of years.
Yes.
He wants to be in us, not just with us. He's not content just to be the creator God. He wants to dwell in his creation. He wants to be one with that creation. He began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Jesus was wide awake. He was totally aware of his oneness with God.
Yes.
And that gave him a boldness. It gave him a confidence. And it gave him peace so that he could image God in his flesh. So he could behold God's presence in his life. And so others could as well. People are not interested in seeing your religion. They're interested in seeing your God.
Yes.
He didn't struggle for God's presence. He just lived in it. Psalms 119, verse 18. I hope nobody thinks that I'm being critical here this morning or being hateful. I don't have an attitude problem. You have a perception problem. Praise the Lord. Just kidding. I'm just saying, look, I want you to be free because that's what God wants, because that's what I want, and because I know deep down inside that's what every one of us wants, or we wouldn't be here. And God wants it more than anybody. He wants it so badly that he gave his life, his human life, so that we could experience it.
Yes.
So that we forever could be one with him.
Yes.
We don't have to wait to die and go to heaven to be one with God. In fact, the great adventure is here and now. It'll go on. I mean, I'm not saying the adventure ends at the end of this natural life. I'm just saying we can have supernatural life here and now in this realm. It should be an adventure. It should be exciting. We should get up every day thinking, okay, Lord, what's on the agenda today? What do you want to do today? I don't have to spend a lot of time praying about it. I just have to be aware that he's in me. And then everything that happens, I recognize is God's doing, trying to show me something or trying to accomplish something in that.
Amen. Right.
Amen. All of creation. We sang the song. So, open thou mine eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. Christianity is supposed to be the practice of being awake and aware of God's presence so that we can behold God's complete presence in our lives, so that we can make a difference. Because how many realize you're not making a big difference? I mean, as a human, just as if humans could make a difference, this world wouldn't be in the crock it's in. We wouldn't have to turn the news off because of its insanity. But what God can do, we know what God can do with 12 people. Began to turn the whole world upside down. We've got them outnumbered right now.
Yes.
In this small church. If we really understood what God's doing in us and wants to do through us, there's just no limit to what he will do. And I'm not talking about being religious. I'm not talking about, you know, going around and acting weird and strange. I'm talking about just being you,
yes,
filled with God.
Yes.
Jesus was not religious. Yes, he kept the religious rituals and rules simply because he otherwise he'd lose his ability to influence. But I'm not really worried about that. as most of you already know, praise the Lord. I'm not trying to prove my religion. Amen. I'm trying to reveal God. I'm trying to get people to see that, look at this guy. And God loves him and dwells in him. Is that possible? Well, then maybe there's hope for me. In fact, if he's in him, there must be hope for me. Amen. Matthew 6, 28 through 30. Open my eyes that I may behold. Why take you thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. Yet as I say unto you, that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Now, I'd just say that he could have just as easily said, O ye of little perception, or O ye of little attention. Look around. Open your eyes. The song we sang, see him in the waves of the sea, in the cry of a baby, in the flight of a bird, in the drops of rain. I believe. Observe, pay attention. Instead of pressing, ponder. God isn't just mindful of us. He wants to meet us. And he wants to meet us in some exact way or personal way. But it's different. There's not a three steps to knowing this. There's just the knowledge of it, the awareness of it. He wants to meet you in an exact way for you. I've had visions. I've had dreams. I've told you some of them. I don't go into all of it. That made no sense to anybody else. But they made perfect sense to me. Because it was exactly for me.
Yes.
I gave up trying to get everybody to get on board with my dream. I had a dream one time. You all have heard this. But in the middle of the night, I woke up and God said, I was praying, and I said, but I have no man. I was really being very spiritual to put me in the pool. I was saying, I have no man, to help me, to kind of help me out here with you, Lord. And the Lord said, I have a man in Dooley, Arkansas. Honest to God, Dooley, Arkansas is not on the map, or at least it wasn't 5 years ago or whenever that was. I told Sally about it, and she looked at me like I was from Dooley, Arkansas. Because it was an exact thing for me. It wasn't for her. And I looked, and I looked, and I looked, and I finally got my daughter to go through all of the Google every map she could find, and she found it, finally. It's an unincorporated area in Arkansas, southern Arkansas, in the middle of nowhere. And I won't go through it all, but I did go down there. I went. I said, Lord, I'm going. I don't know what's going on down there. I don't know what's happening down there. Found a black guy who pastored a church, or didn't pastor a church, but was a part of a church, a small holiness church down there. Which I wasn't connected with any of that. And he thought I wanted a place to preach. And I waited for him all day because he was off. His wife had just passed away. It was a long story. But anyway, I come back to the house. He's there. And he says, I told him, I said, I'm a pastor in Iowa. And, the Lord told me to come down here because he had a man in Dooley, Arkansas. And he looked at me like I was nuts too. But I didn't care. I knew what God had said. And he said, well, what do you want? He said, would you like to speak? I said, I got a place to preach. I'm not looking for a place to preach. I'm looking for the man that God said he had in Dooley, Arkansas. And it must be you. Because I can't find anybody else that's willing to, agree to this. So what do you want? I said, I want you to pray for me. And he prayed. And the words that he spoke were exactly, I didn't tell him what to pray. I didn't tell him what I was looking for, what I was concerned about, what I was troubled with, what I had talked to God about. I just asked him to pray. And he prayed the the exact words that I had said when I was praying to God. Did the light flash and cannons go off and I pass out? No. But I knew this was God. And I don't know to this day. I think it was as much about God saying, are you really listening? Or are you just talking and taking a breath? See, God is talking to us in exact ways, but a lot of times we just blow it off. This just went through my head. Look, you don't get thoughts. Yeah, the enemy can put thoughts there, but we've got our mind renewed to this reality so that God can override those thoughts and take us and do what he wants to do with us and through us. You just can't be afraid to do it. You've got to believe. You've got to be aware that he is in you, that he is making himself known to you. I'm not going to go into this because it was Sally's deal, but she had a vision. The TV was on. She wasn't really even watching it. The TV was just on. And all of a sudden, the TV changed. It wasn't the TV anymore. It was God talking to her. Now, I'm telling you, I'm not going to go into all of it because that was her exact way for God to speak to her, because it brought her to her knees. It told her, hey, God's here. He hears you. He knows what's going on. He's talking to you. Even if it's through Days of Our Lives. It wasn't, because she doesn't watch that, but I'm just saying. But it was TV, and then it was not TV anymore. It was God. And I'm not saying they just said something that sounded like something God would say. I'm saying everything changed. It wasn't even the same thing that was on there. And she knew that it was God. And she shared it with me and told me about it, and I try to be, you know, understanding and polite. But see, it wasn't for me. It wasn't exact to me. It wasn't personal to me. It was personal for her. It was exactly what she needed to hear from God. See, God wants to be personal because he is personal. Yes, he's in all of us, but he's uniquely in you. Yes. He's with you right now. He's present with you. He loves you. He's closer to you than you are to yourself. Last scripture and we'll close. John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. I love that Jamaican. I've got a cow that sings it, in fact. If you can believe that. It's not a real cow. It's a stuffed cow. Don't worry, be happy. It could be in the Bible. It probably is, but maybe not exactly in those words. But if we understand what I'm talking about here this morning, that could be our mantra. That could be our, you know, that could be our motto. That could be what the words that we live by. Don't worry, be happy. God's with you. He'll never leave you or forsake you. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. That's us. Born of God. Perfect union. New creation. Formed in God. Sustained by God. Birthed by God. One with God. That's what I'm looking at. And that's why Paul says, whenever I look in the face of another believer, I just see Christ and him crucified. I see God in that person, in spite of what is looking like on the outside. That's what I'm looking at. That's the reality of each and every one of us. You say, yeah, but I struggle with my faith. Get over it. You had enough faith to believe. That's all it takes. Seed, the grain of a mustard seed. May not seem like much to us, but it's enough. It's all it takes.
Bible says he knew me from the foundation of the earth. He's the Alpha and Omega. As he is, so am I. So I was at the beginning, and I'm at the end. So he truly never has left me
Yep.
Thank you. This was phenomenal.
We think there was a day in our life where we accepted Christ. Well, that's true, you know, linearly speaking or chronologically speaking. But in God, see, the end from the beginning is already done. He knows. This isn't Calvinist speech. I mean, it isn't, you know, predestination in that sense. It's that simply God knows who will receive him. So we were in Christ before the foundation of the world, just as Christ was crucified before the foundation of the world. We just had to go through the human process to make clear to us what God had already done.
Yes.
He knew you in your mother's womb. How'd that work for you? Well, you're here. Right? And now we are in God, and God is in us. It makes all the sense in the world when you think about all the scriptures that talk about he supplies all your need, this and that and the other. That's how it works.
Yes.
It works by being aware and positioning ourselves to receive all the fullness that he has. And it's not just about us. That's great. And it's about us because if we don't get this, I'm telling you, another outreach ain't going to do it. Another day of knocking doors or year of knocking doors and inviting people to church is not going to get this done. God has to be manifest in flesh. It's how it did it the first time. It's how the book of Acts explodes with the presence of God, with God's supernatural. You know, because of the religious mindset, we get all hung up on miracles. And I'm all for miracles, but the truth is, and somebody said it here last week, if we realize who we are and what our relationship to God is, we are blessed, and we walk in blessing. We don't need miracles. It's the people out there that don't know God that need miracles. We shouldn't have to be constantly depending on God to suspend natural laws for us, because we're already supernatural. But our relationship with him has to be one that we're consistently aware of. It's not hard. I mean, this is not difficult. You just, every time the enemy comes, you just think. Just think, because you're thinking all the time, whether you really, you know, I wasn't thinking when I did that. Yeah, you were. You just weren't thinking good. You were just thinking stupid.
Right.
So think about him.
Yes.
Think about his presence.
Yes.
And it will change your life. And just as importantly, it will change the lives of everybody that you encounter, everybody that you interact with.
Amen.
It worked for Jesus. It has to work for us.
Amen.
Because he gave us the same method.
Yes.
He gave us the same, he's the prototype. He gave us the same way of operating.
Yes.
We are his body. Did Jesus have sad things happen? Yeah, he had cousin got killed, and you know, his you know, I mean, there were things that happened, I'm sure, that made Jesus unhappy, because we know that he wept over Lazarus and different times. But he never lost his joy. He never lost the awareness of God being with him. And this wasn't the end, no matter what.
Exactly.
So that he said, with the guy that was I don't know, born blind, I guess it was, or whatever. He said this was for the glory of God, so that people could see that God is here. That God loves, that God wants to be revealed. I mean, this is a great privilege. He chose us, not just to save us, not just to, you know, to get us out of the freeway so we don't get run over by a truck or something. He saves us so that we can control the traffic, so that we can operate on the freeway, so that we can function in all the dysfunction. So, I mean, believe me, there's never been a better time for God to be revealed. Because if we that are believers look at the news and go, my God, what is going on? What do you suppose people that are not believers are thinking?
Exactly.
They're freaking out big time. Because there's no backup plan.
Right.
There's not another way of doing this. You just choose sides, get a bigger gun, and dig a deeper hole. Praise the Lord. There's more to this than that.
Mm-hmm.
there's that God wants us to have joy and peace that passes understanding. And the only way to have that is to have the Prince of Peace alive and well and you aware of it in your life. Praise the Lord. Let's make it our commitment. To every time we realize we're not thinking when we're actually thinking. I mean, how many times, I don't know about anybody else, but how many times a day does that happen when you just all of a sudden you go, whoa, I haven't been thinking about anything. It's like you get a blank page for a moment. Put God in it. Immediately, the moment you're not thinking about some other thing that you're doing or just going through the motions, thinking you're not thinking, then the moment that that reality hits you, when it'll happen multiple times a day, just remind yourself, God's here, God's in me, God's working, God's doing, God is alive and God is loving me and God is moving in my life and he wants to touch somebody. And just listen and see if he doesn't give you an exact representation of himself. Give you something just for you that'll make you aware of that presence.
Yes.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. It'll give you joy unspeakable. And it'll help you to be able to rejoice even when you're not happy. Praise God. God bless all of you. Amen. Go in that reality in the presence of the Lord. Amen. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.